Stanford University.
I think probably the most exciting question that I'm going to kick off with is, obviously, you're nicknamed Super LP. Where does the name Super LP come from? Is it because you invest heroically? Are you like a Superman?
Well,
guys, or what is Super LP?
So I'll say before I get to that, actually, I want to talk about the Super GPs, the guys at Sequoia.
Okay.
And you'll notice I'm a little bit sweaty, and it's because I decided to ride my bike here from my office in downtown Palo Alto. And I think about, as I was doing this, I was thinking about this this interview I'd read with Don Valentine, one of the founders of Sequoia Capital and one of the most kind of heroic investors in history. And Don said that back when they started Sequoia, they wanted to be able to ride their bikes not only to their portfolio companies, but to their portfolio companies' customers, right? This is how local, you know, the business was. Now you think about Sequoia today, and they've got China funds and India funds and growth funds, and they invest, you know, all around the world. But as I was riding my bike and kind of irretrievably lost on campus, the measure of respect for Don Valentine increased. Not only did he have some stamina, because I got really winded coming over here, but he had a great sense of direction to actually get to his portfolio company. So kudos to him. He's one up me. So Super LP is a funny, the provenance of the name, as it were, is pretty funny. One day I was on a trip, and for those of you who don't know what LPs do, we're the money behind the money, right? So we're the guys that, you know, fund the venture capitalists who fund portfolio companies, right? We're a really kind of important constituent in the food chain, although typically very low profile. And we go on these trips. In fact, there's certain times of the year where it's like a traveling party, right? Like, you know, you go to the Europe buyout meetings in April. And, you know, you're in Europe for like 3 weeks, and you're in Stockholm and London and you know, Frankfurt. And you basically see the same people. And I'd seen my friend Du Chai, who then was at Northwestern University's endowment, you know, several days in a row. And at some point, I realized I'd underpacked white t-shirts. And so I put on a red t-shirt, which I'd brought to kind of work out in. And Du sees me and he goes, "Douvos, what's with the red shirt? Are those your Super LP underoos?" So hence a nickname was born. It's not out of any aggrandized vision of myself. In fact, I often say I'd rather be lucky than good, but the Super LP nickname stuck.
So I think you're a hero, but we'll go through your background first. So
awesome.
You started at GASP, not Stanford, but Yale. And after that, you started another GASP, went into consulting. How did those two early experiences kind of shape your decision to go into investing?
So actually, can I tell a quick story?
Yep.
So I went to this fancy boarding school, but I went on full scholarship because my dad was a cab driver. My mom worked at a hotel in New York City. They sent the admissions officers out to find these kind of underprivileged kids. So I go to this fancy boarding school. And my senior year, you know, all these colleges would want, would want our students. So, you know, the Yale guys would send an admissions rep and pitch hard. Princeton, Harvard, Stanford, all the fantastic schools. And I was the captain of the baseball team at Andover. And I walked up to the guy from Stanford afterwards, and I was like, and he was, you know, this is the 90s before Stanford was Stanford. I was talking to the admissions officer who'd come out. I'm like, you know, I really love the idea of Stanford. And he had told this whole story about how Stanford really was looking for Eastern kids to kind of diversify its geographic footprint. Schools back then were much more, much less geographically diverse. And I'm up there, and I'm like, hey, you know, could I come to Stanford? And he goes, well, you know, I told my story. He goes, you know, you'd be a competitive candidate. And I said, well, you know what I'd really like to do is play baseball. And he started laughing. And he said, you know, we just had Mike Messina on the team, who went on to be a Cy Young winner. We just had Jack McDowell was like the starting, who went on to win a Cy Young Award, you know, a couple of Cy Young. He said, son, if you haven't heard from our coach, you're not playing baseball. And right there, my Stanford hopes were dashed. But it's interesting. It was an interesting journey because I actually started at Yale in 1990 when the Yale model of investing was really starting to flourish. And what was awesome is one of my buddies, a guy named Ted Seides, went to the Yale Investment Office in 92. In 93, Lauren Meserve, who's now the deputy CIO, so Ted went on to do a bunch of hedge fund stuff. Lauren Meserve, who's the deputy CIO at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, she was class of 93. I was class of 94. Seth Alexander, who's now CIO at MIT, was class of 95. And there was this amazing kind of group of folks who all, one way or another, eventually got into endowment management. And the thing we learned in those days, because we all took Swenson's class, and Swenson said the most important thing that stuck with me since, but one of them was, he said, investing is about optimizing discomfort. He said, it's not about maximizing discomfort, but optimizing. If you're feeling too comfortable, you're not taking enough risk. And he said, risk is not in itself a dirty word, right? Risk is, there are two kinds of risks in the world, those that you can mitigate and those that you can't. And the ones you can mitigate, he said, you want to spend all your time trying to mitigate them and diversify them away and all that stuff. And the risks that you can't mitigate, you just want to make sure you get compensated adequately for, right? And that was really like profound to me in those days. I was like, whoa, that's actually really kind of cool and interesting. And that's kind of stuck with me ever since.
Mm-hmm. And then, so you joined Princeton.
Yep.
Managing their endowment. How did you end up doing that?
How did
you end up doing that? Oh, so, Yale to Princeton.
So it's interesting because it was super fun because I went back to Yale for business school and I was actually talking to my buddy Seth who was then in the investments office. And I just spent this miserable summer at Morgan Stanley. And I came back and I said, you know, I want to be a principal, not an agent. And Seth said, you know, managing an endowment is the closest I'll ever come to being, you know, managing my own multi-billion dollar fortune, right? He's like, we have low liquidity needs, long tax horizon, no tax headaches or few tax headaches, etc. There are all these like great dynamics. He says it's a fantastic, you know, place to be a pure investor. And this kind of captivated me. I said, hey, Seth, can I come, you know, you think Dave would hire me? And Seth said, you know, we only hire undergrads. You missed your chance, kid. But you should talk to the Princeton guys. And so I went and talked to the Princeton guys, and Seth said, when you go talk to them about timber. And timber then was the most en vogue asset class. And timber has all these like really cool attributes. Like if the price for timber is bad, you just leave the trees in the ground and they get bigger, right? Like they grow organically. It's like awesome. And not only do they grow organically, but then you get these like step functions in value because you get harder woods, right? And so I went and I spent my whole, I'd had this 5-minute conversation with Seth about timber, and I spent 45 minutes talking to Andy, the CIO, about timber, and I felt so smart. He's like, wow, you're really thoughtful. And I was like, yes. And so I got a job at Princeton, and these managers would always come in. I'm sorry, I'll just tell the story quickly. These managers would always come in, and they would have come from Harvard, where they'd met with Peter Dolan and those guys who were all Harvard alums. They'd gone through New Haven, and they'd met with Tim Sullivan and Swenson and Takahashi, and they were all Yale alums. They came to Princeton, and they said, you know, are you guys Princeton alums? We didn't have a single Princeton alum in our office. Isn't that crazy? And so it was kind of an awkward question always, so to break the ice, I say, well, you know, I didn't go to Princeton, but I went to Yale not once, but twice. And as they said in Roman times, ubi panis, ibi patria, where there is bread, there is my country. And Princeton's got a lot of bread, so I'm behind enemy lines. And people get a kick out of that and it would break the ice. But one day, the managing director of private equity elbowed me and said, Douvos, you got to quit it with the Latin stuff. And so that was my...
Talk more about timber.
Yeah, exactly. Talk more about timber.
It's prep school.
Right. Ecce Romani. But Princeton was an amazing place because it was a really intense learning environment because it was 2001 and 2004. So, you know, it's really funny because now what I do on a daily basis is I interview venture capitalists, right? And they're trying to sell me on their funds. That's all, I mean, literally I have 3 to 5 meetings a day with VCs. And I'm trying to, you know, understand what their behavioral footprint is, how that translates into, you know, kind of potential investment success, what are they afraid of, what risks are they willing to take, what risks are they unwilling to take, all that kind of stuff. And where was I going with that?
Well, I'm curious in terms of, so that's what you're doing right now at VIA. Yep. How does, and you've been at a couple different funds, Princeton, TIFF, VIA now, like, yep. How do each of those funds think about venture capital as an asset class?
Yeah, and that's where I was going. Thank you for getting me back on track. I meet with all these VCs now who are like, you know, we lived through a downturn. We lived through 2008, mm-hmm. right? And I'm like, 2008 wasn't a downturn, right? Because the downturn was shorter than a typical company funding cycle, right? Mm-hmm. At Princeton in 2001, we were sitting there and it was like just this grinding painful, endless, asymptotic to, to 0.2x kind of downturn that lasted years, right? And good companies died. And so it was a really interesting place to be during that time. But it's interesting because I've gone from a .edu to a .org to a .com, right, in a sense. And so what was awesome about Princeton in those days is we had a ton of flexibility, mm-hmm. right? And we could, literally do anything. We had this amazing existing portfolio, and we could walk into any manager with kind of, a big orange P on our chest and get access, right? It was pretty awesome. When I went to TIFF, I was actually, but at Princeton we were a little bit conservative, right? Because what we did had a lot of scrutiny. And then kind of to your point about investing heroically earlier, I left Princeton to go to TIFF, the Investment Fund for Foundations, because our chief investment officer, who was like a real contrarian and had trained under Jeremy Grantham, he said, "Douvos, I want you to invest heroically. I want you to invest courageously without any sense of career risk." In fact, this is my slide. Like, hold on, I love this slide because David Salem, our founder, said, most investors are either, you can be right or wrong. Like good decisions sometimes have bad outcomes and vice versa. So on this left axis is, each individual decision. And, good investors can kind of, it's a distribution, you can kind of skew toward the, kind of right end of the spectrum. He said, the real choice you have is whether you're with the crowd or alone, right? And most investors are so afraid of being in this box, right? And this is, and we'll talk more about the principal agent risk because it's one of my big, it's one of the big things I learned at TIFF, the agency costs of investing. 80 to 90% of decisions in finance, according to Jeremy Grantham, take first into account career risk, right? So people are so afraid of being wrong and alone that they want to take this box completely out of play. And the only way to take this box completely out of play is to be with the crowd and do the conventional thing, right? This is what Lord Keynes tells us. It's better for the reputation to fail conventionally than to succeed unconventionally, right? But Salem said to me, he said, "Douvos, I want you to be unafraid of being wrong and alone, because if you're unafraid of being wrong and alone, then every now and again you're going to be right and alone, and that's the box where fortune and glory reside." And I was like, oh my gosh, this is amazing, right? So all of a sudden I was unshackled. At Princeton, we were very conservative, very, hidebound. Princeton did some cool things, but they still drew within the lines. Mm-hmm. At TIFF, all of a sudden I was completely unshackled, right? Mm-hmm. And there was some really interesting stuff going on in entrepreneurial finance. And at the time, that was like 2004, 5, 6. So we'll talk about that. But it was an amazing moment, right? Like I wasn't like smarter than the next guy. I was just luckier that I had like all this, all this kind of institutional coverage for doing the unconventional thing.
Yeah. So can we talk a little bit about that principal agent problem that you just mentioned? And I guess like how does this manifest in the world of institutional investors?
So, it's interesting because the principal agent problem, just to give a shorthand definition of it for those who are not hip, because it is actually the most kind of profound problem in investing. And it's basically people who are the owners of the money, principals, would act differently than the agents, those people who are entrusted with managing their money. So by the way, a basic example, my kid was asking me about, what is the principal agent problem? I said, look, when we go to Subway, which I try not to do that often, there's an owner of Subway, actually, I think they're shareholders, right? And they want, they want them to put 6 slices of, meat on the sandwich. But, you get somebody, you start like jibber-jabbering them, you start sweet-talking them, and you say, hey, you mind putting an extra salami on there? And you'll get 9 salamis, right? The person who's making the sandwich is more interested in kind of creating that relationship with me or not having me like yell at them or whatever bad behavior happens in Subways. They've got a certain set, a certain behavioral footprint and a certain set of preferences that may not be in alignment with the owners of those means of production. And so in investing, it's actually really interesting because you think about all the steps, right? So I'm at a fund of funds, right? So I go out and I raise money from predominantly nonprofits, right? So Carnegie Mellon University, DuPont Trust, Case Western University, they give me money. Then I invest that money in VCs, and then those VCs fund portfolio companies. there are a lot of steps from point A to point B along that chain, right? And at each step, there's a potential misalignment. So for instance, I, as a fund-to-fund manager now, my own behavioral footprint is I do what I do for the love of the game, right? And I love building community, and I'm not coin operated, as it were. But there are a lot of people in finance who are asset gatherers because that's the way to maximize wealth. So as a fund-to-fund investor, you might say, huh, let's raise larger and larger funds because that impacts, you know, our current income, you know, much more so than making good investments that might pay off, you know, 5 years hence. And so, you know, you might see assets grow, right? Similarly, then the venture capitalists might, you know, they might want to be, you know, they might want to be the cool kid investing in the hot sector, right? Or they might want to, you know, they might want to maximize fee income, or they might want to call in rich and have a fund and just, you know, kind of. So at every step, there's a, you know, and the portfolio companies, you know, people, right? So at every step, you've got to find kind of how do we align interests, right? And one of the challenges of my trade craft is like, not only how do you align interests like in a monetary sense, because that's what everybody always thinks, like, let's get the documents right, but it's really important to get that kind of psychographic alignment of interest, right? Making sure that everybody is on the same page with respect to like our own expectations of each other and our own kind of the way we're going to manage money. I don't know if that's a good answer, but this is something I stress out a lot about.
Yeah, so I guess like there's all these asset classes that institutional investors invest in. VC is obviously one of the riskiest ones. Like, how does an institutional investor typically think about putting VC in their portfolio? And like, even like, it's so risky, how do you even think about which VC funds to pick in the first place?
You know, it's really interesting because this is like one of my hot button issues because venture capital is the longest dated, furthest out of the money option that people can buy, right? And what's interesting to me is we're in this echo chamber, right? Like a 30-mile, drop a pin right here or maybe like 200 yards that way and draw a 30-mile radius, and there's this amazing echo chamber, right? It's a fantastically productive, you know, innovative, you know, kind of area. But what happens is people kind of lose sight of what I call Buffett's equation, right? And Buffett's equation is value, opportunity equals value minus perception, right? Mm-hmm. And so as perception grows, you know, it's an inverse relationship to value around this, to opportunity around this pivot of kind of intrinsic value. And so, so it's funny because you go to endowments or any kind of multi-asset, you know, entity, and you might see, you know, I was a model jockey at Princeton, right? I'd taken, you know, kind of linear programming in business school, and that they made me, you know, do the asset allocation. So this is actually Princeton's 2003 asset allocation. For those of you, I'm sure most of you had taken, you know, kind of modern portfolio theory. A lot of this stuff was invented here. What's that?
Bill Sharp.
Yeah, exactly.
We started fighting.
Exactly, right? So, you know, we used to sit around and debate, okay, so, you know, you kind of stack rank, you know, there are three inputs for every asset class, the expected return of that asset class, the risk of that asset class as expressed by standard deviation or volatility was actually a terrible way to assess venture risk, and we can talk about that in a second. And then the correlations, you have a correlation matrix, right? And you smash all three of these things into a piece of software, and you basically get these plots, and then this efficient frontier is kind of your best outcome if you kind of, you know, optimize around, you know, the kind of mixes between these assets. And, you know, VC was out here at highest return at the highest risk. Now, by the way, when I used to prepare this slide for the board books every year, I'd put in like goofy asset classes. Like down here, I'd put like baseball cards or like rare coins or stamps. And people are like, really, really, CD? And I'm like, well, you know, the optimizer just kicks them out because they add neither to the risk nor the return. So, you know, VC is this, you know, amazingly long dated, way out of the money, you know, option. But what it does is it enhances return, right? And, but here's what's tricky, right? So, you know, and this is something I'd love to sensitize people in the entrepreneurial community to. You know, if you go to, you know, people seem to think that venture deserves capital, right? But venture exists in this complex, you know, lambada of all these asset classes kind of crashing into each other, right? And you go into, you sit in on a Monday meeting. I wrote this blog post a while back called Speak Like the Locals, right? And all these asset classes have these very complex and well-established languages, right, for risk and return and the balance. So, you know, the hedge fund guy will, or guy, gender neutral, will sit there and say, well, you know, this fund that we're looking at has, you know, a Sharpe ratio of X and an information ratio of Y and, you know, blah, blah. And the public markets person will talk about, you know, kind of volatility and semi-variance. And then the venture, you know, the venture person, it comes time for them to talk, and I say, well, you know, I like Sequoia Capital because of the team. And you're just like, okay. You know, and there's no way, you know, it's kind of like this, it was something that became acute to me, like you're just asking people to take this leap, mm-hmm. right? And now here's where it kind of it comes around. You know, why do they take this leap? Mm-hmm. Because it's career risk not to, right? Mm-hmm. Because Swenson said, you know, when I was at TIFF, I used to pitch to small nonprofits who couldn't afford their own investments office. And I'd fly out to Dubuque and pitch, you know, the Central Iowa, you know, charitable foundation or whatever. And I'd sit down and everybody would have a copy of David Swenson's book. And I'd say, and now for a reading from the book of David. And I'd pull out my own comment, please turn to page 236. And that's where it'd say, you know, venture capital is an important part of every portfolio. And so everybody wanted it, but they didn't know why,
yeah.
right? And they wanted it because it was the crowd thing to do. And if they were right, they would be competent. And if they were wrong, it would just be mediocre. But they didn't realize that true venture capital kind of exists, you know, in the kind of alone quadrant. Did that answer the question?
Yeah, definitely. So how do you decide on which VC funds to invest in? So obviously, like, team's a huge aspect of it. It's like you're not looking at all these like ratios and numbers, but like, how do you exactly assess team? Do you look at only first-time funds, or like, how do you think about all that?
It's a real challenge because it is a black art, right? Mm-hmm. It's total voodoo, and I say that half flippantly. But in most asset classes, past performance is indicative of future success, somewhat, even though the SEC tells you that it's not. But there is persistence of performance. And people think that there's persistence of performance in VC, but surprisingly, there's actually not. Right? There are a small number of firms who do persist, but Cambridge Associates late last year came out with a study that looked at over the last 10 years the top 10 performing funds, and on average more than half were brand new funds, and then I think another quarter were funds numeral two through four. Mm-hmm. That's a really interesting and profound, you know, kind of, that's almost like Copernicus saying, you know, the world revolves around the sun, not vice versa, right? For a lot of people who are backwards looking, you know, that was really eye-opening. Yeah.
Do you think it's also like the size of the fund that actually affects that data?
So I believe that to be true. Mm-hmm. I also believe here's a principal agent problem, right? This is mm-hmm. kind of classic principal agent problem. So if you're an asset allocator and you're at, you know, the University of Southwestern Oregon, I'm gonna make that up. and your venture allocation is X percent, because the way a lot of these people come up with allocations is they have a consultant, and a consultant does a model like that, and they say, your venture allocation must be X. And then, you know, this, you know, investor that doesn't have a lot of, you know, cred, doesn't have a lot of insight, you know, they can't get in the top 20 or 30 firms, and they start kind of going down the list. But in some cases, you know, they've got to write $100 million checks, $200 million checks, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, there's certain firms who, some of whom are very good, right? But like firms like NEA or Oak or other firms exist in part to allow people to kind of vector their allocations into venture capital in a mm-hmm. way that that they can kind of do in size, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's actually funny. I remember when I was in consulting, we talked about this really interesting fact. You know, every year J.D. Power and Associates, whoever, tries to figure out which was the car that was most likely to get rebought. So if I owned a Chevy Impala, you know, what would the odds be of me rebuying an Impala, right? And the car with the number one, you know, the person when they did this, you know, exercise of this, they're like, what do you think it is? And, you know, people say Honda Civic or Toyota Camry or whatever. Turns out number one at the time was a Chevy Suburban. And the reason people were most likely to repurchase a Suburban is if you have seven kids and you have four kayaks and three bikes and everything, that was the only car for you, right? So people like ask me sometimes, they're like, well, you know, if all the performance data is unequivocal that smaller funds outperform, why do big funds exist? Well, big funds exist because people need to move their kayaks and their seven kids, right? They need to vector the capital somewhere. So that was a very long, you know, kind of roundabout answer to the question, which is, this is my own kind of methodology, right? And by the way, I'll tell you, when I got to Princeton, our number one performing fund was a fund called Oak, right? And Oak is a fine fund, that was historically our A number one performing relationship. And we'd made a lot of money in the Oak 1, which was $75 million, and Oak 2, which was $150 million, and Oak 3, which was, you know, $300 million, and Oak 4, which was $600 million. Mm-hmm. But then their bubble era fund was $1.2 billion, and then their next one was $2.4 billion, and then they raised another one since. Mm-hmm. And by the way, you know, well, I'll just leave it at that. And as you, what was interesting to me is there's a guy, the guy who committed the fraud and went off to India. I forget his name, but this is a famous thing. The general partner at Oak like made up all these trades and pocketed a bunch of money and fled mm-hmm. to India. So there's an article about Oak yeah. in Institutional Investor, and they had the returns mm-hmm. because the University of Washington has to publish them, because University of Washington has to invest, because that's the only place they can stuff $300 million, right? And the returns were like 1.3%, negative 2.4%. They were like completely, you know, worse than market returns. Yeah. And but if you, you know, most LPs start with performance, right? They say, you know, but the fact is that, like, because venture, right, you know, we invest in portfolio companies that take 7 years to come to maturity, right? On average, 7 years to IPO, you know, whatever mm-hmm. the numbers are today exactly. And so, you know, by the time you're actually seeing results, it's almost like looking, you know, through the Hubble Space Telescope back in time, right? You know, those are the investments that somebody did 10 years ago, and their own kind of motivations and footprint and all that stuff might be completely different. They might be in a different life place. They might have, you know, had, you know, kids go and join the French Foreign Legion, you know, like any number of things personally that might affect, you know, kind of their focus on investing, what have you. And so most investors start with performance, but I put it last. So for me, it's people, and like I said before, you know, I try to understand, you know, the people and their mm-hmm. kind of distinctive, sustainable competitive advantage. Mm-hmm. What is it about this individual and the way they invest? Because as a funds investor, I don't get to invest in assets. Mm-hmm. I invest in individuals, right? Yeah. So how is it that somebody is going to have a repeatable process for finding outstanding investments? They have differential deal flow. Mm-hmm. Can they, you know, do they have a better investment engine than mm-hmm. the next person? Can they think about, you know, the yes or no decision? Thank you.
Better. I'm sure you're probably investing in not just people, but also teams. Mm-hmm. So I'll let you finish that thought. Mm-hmm. And then also if you can highlight, like, how do you assess teams as well?
So, you know, it was funny because I think about the first time I did this, and by the way, not a lot of people do this, and I don't say that to be, you know, rah-rah me. It's mm-hmm. it's sometimes different is different. It's not better, right? Mm-hmm. And I've missed a lot of really good things. But mm-hmm. I remember the first time I tried this is like 05, and there was a group called O'Reilly Alpha Tech Ventures, which is mm-hmm. one of the kind of early pioneering seed funds. And I remember I was like, you know, I'm going to do this. It was a team that had just come together, Bryce Roberts and Mark Jacobson. They hadn't worked together before, although they had a bunch of interesting affinities. And I met them at the Westin Airport Hotel up at SFO, and we just sat there, and I'm like, all right, I'm gonna talk to Bryce for an hour. Mark, you know, go hang out. Mm-hmm. Then swap. I'm gonna talk to you, Mark, for an hour. Then I'm gonna talk to you together for an hour. And then I'm gonna talk to you each individually again. It was the most amazing thing because it was like total like insight into kind of who these people were as humans, but then also how, you know, every great partnership is a well-rounded whole that's made up of jagged pieces that fit together nicely, mm-hmm. right? And so so talking to those guys and hashing through was really eye-opening, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, but the other thing I've learned in doing this is that there's no one kind of model of success, right? Some venture funds work like basketball teams, others work like tennis teams, where everybody's playing their own match, right? Mm-hmm. And so you need to understand kind of, again, how people find their authentic self and their authentic behavioral footprint, right? Yeah. So understanding the people for me comes first. Thinking about the strategy, and for me, I don't have a monopoly on wisdom on strategy, mm-hmm. right? Because I don't know if, you know, nano is going to be the next big thing, or you know, security or AI or VR or whatever. Mm-hmm. What I want to make sure is that the people and the strategy fit. And you'd mm-hmm. be amazed at how often, and this actually, I see this has a big impact on portfolio company founders and teams, right? When people who are trying to behave a certain way, but that's not authentic to kind of how they work, you know, it creates all kinds of tensions, right? I'll give an example from the buyout side, but it's amazing how many times, like in the buyout world, you see these teams, like senior managers from Procter & Gamble coming through to, you know, to pitch their fund that is going to invest in, you know, kind of small cap, you know, growing companies, right? And you're just like, wait, at Procter & Gamble, you were like, we have great operational experience. No, you manage a staff, right? You weren't actually like a line manager, you manage a staff. You're not going to have a staff in these like janky companies where the factory roof is falling in, right? And so it's amazing how little awareness people, and I see that on the venture side, actually a decent amount. And so what I look for is the resonance, and then out of that, out of the people and strategy falls the portfolio. That's the people and the strategy in action. And so that's where I like to spend a lot of my time, is talking to, you know, portfolio companies, kind of founding teams and management teams, especially as they grow, and understanding how the company is better off for having had that venture capitalist's, you know, kind of insight and involvement, or how the venture capitalist's been, you know, kind of difficult or disruptive, which is sometimes the case. And that's really where I spend the bulk of my time. And out of the portfolio will eventually come performance, and I try to kind of, you know, guess. But somewhere in that last, you know, drop arrow is magic, right?
Yeah.
And good luck.
Yeah. So a couple questions on this. So in terms of strategy, like what makes an investment thesis or a strategy unique beyond like assuming that there's a perfect fit between kind of people and strategy, like what actually makes that strategy unique?
You know, it's
like, I'm sure everyone can pitch to you, like, we're going to be an AI fund, we're going to be a biotech fund.
Yeah.
We're going to like find the best startups by doing XYZ. Like, how can you actually tell that that strategy is going to work?
You know, it's interesting because that's actually, by the way, this wasn't a setup. I sent, as you could attest, I sent you these slides at like noon today.
Yeah.
But so it's a very thoughtful question, because my answer, in part, takes into account this chart, right? And you know, micro VC isn't the whole world of VC, but it's kind of the area with most kind of innovation and tumult right now, and the number of micro VCs, especially in the Bay Area, has exploded, which means that the number of companies that are getting funded has exploded. And by the way, you know, these funds will have, you know, 10-year lives, but they'll have investment periods of 2 to 3 years, right? So there's a permanence to this kind of activity. So this question of uniqueness or distinctiveness is really kind of profound right now, because we're in this kind of hectic, you know, echo chamber.
Mm-hmm. I'm just curious, how do you classify micro VC? Does that include accelerators,
So the short answer is that I've cribbed this from First Republic, and so I don't know what all is in there, but I would suspect, like for instance, I know Lemnos Labs is in here, and that's kind of a hybrid, that's one of my investments, and that's a hybrid, you know, kind of accelerator slash fund. So I would suspect that this does include accelerators and incubators and actual funds under $100 million. Mm-hmm. So to this question of distinctiveness, I mean, answer in a really generic way. I'm looking for somebody that has a point of view, right? And so, and a strong kind of well-formed opinion, because so many of these people are just chasing the hot deal, right? Mm-hmm. They're running around Twitter waiting for the next programmer to spin out, right? and so I think of people, you know, like Kirsten Green, who's had a lot of success. I'm not an investor. And I kudos to her for her success. I didn't see it, but she, you know, she actually passed my test of having a point of view, because she's so deep and thoughtful with respect to e-commerce, that she has some real opinions about the future, as opposed to, so she's proactive in her investing rather than reactive. And I think that's an attribute that can't be underestimated.
Got it.
Just on a couple of your previous nuggets, would that class of people generally be viewed by you as contrarian? So a plausible story that's counterstream to get an upper right?
I think that's right. I think you have to, so that's another way of putting, you know, contrarians are courageous in a sense, right? And so I think that's, I look, you know, in fact, actually one of my slides here, where'd it go? I thought I was really clever when I named this. You know, what I'm actually looking for in this is the name of an alumni award at my school that I'll never, my high school that I'll never get. But the award is give me a robust nonconformist who has the courage of his or her convictions, right? And that's actually what I'm looking for. That's probably the best way to articulate it, a robust nonconformist with courage of conviction.
Question?
Yeah, I was gonna ask just about the micro VCs in general, or when you're like choosing VCs and stuff for, I guess, your higher level portfolio, do you then like to, I guess, balance your risk by saying, this person's all in this area, this person's all in this area, and then it forms like that nicer distribution, so to
yeah.
speak?
So the short answer is that a lot of people do think about investing that way. So they'll, you know, look to complement. They might be enterprise heavy, and they'll look to add, you know, kind of an e-commerce investor, or you know, or consumer investor, focused investor, and they like to create balance that way. You know, I would be not taking my own or you know, not fulfilling my own kind of requirements of managers if I was trying to kind of match the world that way. So I've got, you know, kind of points of view about kind of real technology and, you know, so, you know, right now I'm radically underweight consumer stuff, but I'm looking at things like material science, right? And kind of, you know, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, you know, was looking at big data, and in a sense applied big data is deep learning and AI. So I didn't, you know, I wasn't calling it AI then, but like, you know, I'd kind of fallen in with a bunch of people, you know, and actually this is like great advice for if I were sitting in your seats. I was hanging out with Mike Maples the other day, and he runs a fund called Floodgate Fund that's been radically successful. And I said, Mike, you know, how's your success so repeatable? And he says, you know, I'm always looking to meet with 10 people a week that are really, really smart that nobody else is meeting with. I was like, wow, that's actually really interesting. He told a story, you know, about the Twitch team and where he found those guys, and you know, all these kind of teams that, you know, and he's done a bunch of stuff in Austin. But meeting people and those frictional interactions. So no matter where you guys end up, right? Like, you know, I remember when I was coming out of, you know, grad school, I was like, you know, I'm gonna stick my head down and like do the work really well. Mm-hmm. What I realized only later was like, what you actually get is, you know, the best thing you can ask for is like having these sparks, right, from the friction with people. In fact, the guy who ran private equity here at Stanford, even though I didn't spend a lot of time with him because he retired as I was coming into the business, is a guy named Harry Turner. And Harry was a great professional. And Harry said, I'm never gonna have lunch alone. And he was here in Palo Alto, right? And would always have, you know, would meet somebody different on Sand Hill Road or Ilfurnai or what have you. And the amount of like, you know, all that we are as individuals is we're intelligent switches in the middle of this amazingly disparate and, you know, in your guys' case, high quality network, right? And so you're constantly getting bombarded by information, and you're kind of trying to manage that throughput. But by adding that layer of kind of, you know, intelligence on top of, you know, your switch, your place in the network, you can actually find some really amazing stuff if you just like pause to listen. Mm-hmm.
So I guess going back to the four characteristics slide, I don't know if it's on the back or...
This one?
This one. So performance and portfolio. So when you're investing in a fund that's a first-time fund, mm-hmm. they might not have that, or they definitely don't have it from a fund perspective. They might have it as like an individual investor perspective, but how do you actually measure that for first-time funds? Or do you just not invest in first-time funds?
So I invest in a lot of first-time funds. Okay. Let me tell a story. Mm-hmm. So it was like 04, and you know, everybody was taught, you know, and I made this rule for myself, you know, because at Princeton we would run up and down Sand Hill Road and talk to, you know, hey, John Doerr, who's doing good work today? Hey, Mike Moritz, who's doing good work today? And what we'd get is we'd get warmed over conventional wisdom, right? Mm-hmm. And so I said, you know, I was a history major in college, right? It's a, you know, pretty useless major, although it allowed me to kind of think. But in terms of kind of practical stuff, you know, I learned a ton. I learned how to write. But with respect to kind of tradecraft, right, mm-hmm. history is a study of primary sources, right? In fact, Herodotus, the first historian, gives us the word history, and historiae means telling stories, right? Mm-hmm. And the book, The History, is like the first tome of history, mm-hmm. is him basically walking around from place to place, and he's like, and then I found myself in the land of the Lysistratons, and among the Lysistratan myths are blah, blah, blah. And so mm-hmm. I was like, and then I found myself in Technopia. And among the technopians, they say that, like, you know, and it was like amazing to be running around, you know, the Bay Area in 2004, because everything that was going on with, you know, EC2 and AWS and, like, you know, the decline in cost to start a company was really starting to change, you know, the dynamics, and it was amazing. And I would ask people, so I set a rule for myself. I said, I'm going to be Herodotus. For every hour I spend with a VC, I'm going to spend an hour with an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. And I'd show up, you know, at these offices in Redwood City or, you know, Midtown Palo Alto or south of Market with two cases of beer on a Friday afternoon and drink with the team. And I'd ask, you know, who gets this stuff? And a name that kept coming up was this guy in Philadelphia, Josh Koppelman, right? Mm-hmm. And Josh had sold a company called half.com. to eBay. And by the way, quick story, the first board meeting once Half had been acquired by eBay, Josh, one of Josh's last things, like the ladies in the room might not know what these are, but in men's rooms, like there's the urinal and there's a thing that, I don't know what the name is, but we call them toilet mints, right? And then there's a like basket on top of them so they don't slide around too much. And Josh had authorized this expenditure to say, like, you know, don't piss half your money away, go to half.com, right, to buy half price books. So Josh authorized this, and the sales team fanned out and put these in men's rooms all around the country. And the first board meeting, Josh sits down, and Meg Whitman looks over at him and just says, so I hear people are urinating all over our brand name. We need to fix this right away. So his first, you know, task at eBay was to go and undo his last, you know, his last task at half.com. Yeah, long story short, so there I was sitting with Josh, who turned out to be in Philadelphia, right? And actually, remind me, double click on that in a second. But Josh and I started talking about, you know, kind of the changes in venture capital at the time and what today we call lean startup. And Josh was like, you know, we're going to be able to, like, think about, you know, portfolios in a different way. And by the way, with a modest amount of capital, and Josh hadn't done a whole lot of investing, right? He's a serial entrepreneur. With a very modest amount of capital, we can invest in a number of companies. And when we invest in a number of companies, we can have scale and scope, right? And when we have scale and scope, we can become the Napster of venture capital. And I was like, that, you know, Napster's kind of passe, but what if you think of it as portfolio as community, right? And so today, if you go into any first round office, it says portfolio, it's crossed out and says community underneath. And that's like my, you know, I want that on my tombstone. Like Chris came up with this. Let's say, you know, it's all been downhill from there. But it's awesome because Josh was articulating a new way of doing venture capital. Mm-hmm. How can we make the venture firm an intelligent hub, right? But not a bottleneck, right? How do we push the interactions to the core, from the core of the network out to the frontiers of the network, right? Mm-hmm. So, and it's interesting. So then you kind of start layering some services, and, you know, Andreessen Horowitz has copied some of this stuff, and then, you know, everybody seems to want to build a platform now. Yeah. But you know, it was really different and differentiated. And then the other thing I'll say, the double click from Philadelphia was, you know, somebody wrote a book that I read in college that talked about creativity. And they said, you know, very rarely does creativity come from within the college, right? And not colleges in, you know, Stanford, but within kind of the community of kind of the consensus, right? Oftentimes, you know, you have these outsiders, right? Who, you know, Einstein was the ultimate outsider, right? Like all these outsiders have the freedom to experiment, right? And they come up with these, like, you know, really discontinuous ideas that change the perception. And so that's why, you know, it was so, when I would think about that when I was sitting there with Josh in Philadelphia, as, you know, at the Conshohocken Marriott, West Conshohocken Marriott is as far from Silicon Valley as you can get. And I was thinking, wow, we're actually re-envisioning venture capital right here in 2004. And it's amazing how much of the history of venture capital since, you know, kind of came out of that.
So how do you decide on, once you've invested in a fund, how do you decide on if you want to invest in their fund 2, fund 3, maybe skip fund 4, continue to invest in 5, 6? Or is it the case in which if you skip one fund, then you're just like booted from that fund forever? Like, so for example, like I'm sure if a new LP wanted to invest in Sequoia, if they didn't invest in their early funds, they definitely can't invest in their latest fund because it's been oversubscribed. So how do you think about like which of those funds to invest in?
So starting from the beginning of the question, whenever you make a commitment, I almost think of it as a two fund commitment, right? Because in the 2 to 4 year horizon between fund one fundraise and fund two fundraise, there's no way we're gonna gather enough information, right? There may be dispositive negatives, like people who radically stray from their, you know, kind of theses, or you know, or Formation 8, which you know kind of blew up because of people, you know, or what have you. So you'll see, you know, kind of, but that's the exception rather than the rule. The rule is, you know, you'll do Fund 2, and so then you've got kind of 4 to 6 years usually of history by the time you have to make a decision on Fund 3, right? And now you won't have performance yet, but you'll have telltales in the portfolio. And so that's why it's important to spend, you know, now a lot of investors will then be on, you know, kind of inertia, like, and, and they'll kind of, you know, do their thing, and they'll wake up, you know, at kind of Fund 4 or 5, and they'll say like, you know, what are we doing here? This is the last time we're gonna give these people money until the next time they come in, and this is the last time we're gonna give these people money. But you know, that's when you, you know, Fund 3 becomes a really important decision, right? And that's, and you know, for me, that's just labor intensive, and having, you know, and I try to be on advisory boards when I invest in funds, so I try to be a meaningful and early investor. And so by being on the advisory board, you get an extra, you know, kind of layer of insight. But the truth is, once you say no to a fund, or even if you, you know, even if you never were in the fund, like I've had funds that I've said, I said no to early on, you know, that, that were raising, that, where that was the one chance. Like, if you didn't go into first round FRC 2, which was raised in 2008, the first institutional fund, there's, there was never another opportunity to get into FRC. The, you know, the exception to that rule is if you're a premium branded school with alums. So, you know, I'd say there are probably 5 schools, Stanford, Harvard, Princeton, Yale, and then whatever school has alums at that GP. And you know, there's a story, I don't know if it's true or not, but I tell it as if it were, but I've heard it so many times that, you know, apparently Yale stepped away from Sequoia when Valentine and Lamond were stepping back and handing the reins to Leone and Moritz. And apparently, as the story goes, which I think may be apocryphal, Don Valentine handed David Swensen a letter and said, you know, Yale's been such a great partner since inception. We've been, it's been such an honor to manage money for Yale. If Yale ever wants back in, you know, please call and we'll make room. So apparently then Sequoia had a couple of funds, like the Yahoo Fund and another fund, so Sequoia 6 and 7. And Swensen and his team went back to Sequoia with this letter and handed it to Doug Leone, and Doug Leone looks at it in typical Doug Leone fashion, goes, "Ch-ch-ch." That was your get out of jail free card. You never get one of those again. And you know, we took great pride at Princeton that our allocation, because then they had to like sneak, you know, Yale into, back into the fund. And so our allocation was, you know, kind of 5x what Yale's was. And so that allowed us to kind of get a little ahead. But it, that's, again, the exception that proves the rule.
Okay, so pretend for a second
that
you're a GP at a fund and you're in charge of raising this $50, $100 million fund. What would you look for personally in LPs?
So the first thing you'd look for is an institution that has a long horizon, long investment horizon, and isn't going to get skittish, right? And part of the challenge, and I put up the slide with the 300 some odd, you know, funds, and so much money is coming in, and you know, we've seen the LP tourist movie before, and what happens is when things get tough, you know, the capital rushes out of the room, and the guys at First Republic said, you know, of those 300 some, you know, small funds, 2/3 have one institutional investor. And if that institutional investor goes away, the fund is dead, right? Like, who's gonna fill that hole? You know, for a new institutional investor to come in, there would be a lot of questions around, you know, why did these people know? What do they know that we, why do they leave? What do they know that we don't, et cetera? And so there are a lot of funds out there in very precarious situations. So if I were a GP, that's, you know, that multi-horizon, you know, kind of patient outlook, right, is a number one. Secondly, you know, it's interesting because increasingly VCs are looking for LPs that can be strategic, right? So some, you know, and in some cases this is in tension with being, you know, being a long horizon investor, but you know, some of these corporate VCs actually can be very value added by making introductions and what have you. But then corporate VCs tend to be a little fickle as well, so that's a challenge.
So I guess on that note, like, kind of there's a trend towards LPs directly investing in portfolio companies. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
So that's a really interesting question, and I have a very complicated answer. that starts, you know, with the presumption that LPs co-investing tends to never end well, right? We saw it in venture in the late 90s. We saw it in the buyout world in kind of 2004 to 2007. And now we're seeing it again in venture. Now, that said, I've done 25 co-investments in the last 3 years. So, and it's interesting because for some people, you know, again, kind of a principal agent problem, right? There's a few things going on. So some people, like there's some university endowments that are co-investing because they want to bring their fees down, right? Their blended fee, because co-investments tend to be free. But what we saw in the buyout world was that, you know, in kind of 2006, 2007, buyout funds started charging a carry, a reduced carry, but a carry nonetheless, and management fees. So basically it's like a lightweight fund, right? So you start, you know, you start losing that fee benefit. You know, there's some people at fund-to-funds who are co-investing because they see the fund-to-funds business dying off, right? And so they've got to find kind of new ways to, you know, new revenue streams, new ways to stay relevant, new ways to, you know, the reason I do it is because I see a lot of companies that have a lot of technology risk. So they're doing like crazy, you know, like one of our companies is a, you know, novel process for 3D metal printing, or metal 3D printing. You know, another one's trying to reinvent how carbon fiber is laid down. So, you know, some interesting stuff that tends to be underfunded. So I'm trying to find, you know, that again in Buffett's equation, opportunity equals value minus perception. I think we're seeking big opportunity because the perception is so low because these companies are kind of off the beaten path.
Yeah. So I think we're kind of naturally transitioning into a kind of critical set of questions I'm going to ask you around current trends. So one of them that includes, so VCs typically, like we've seen VCs in, kind of raise funds maybe like every 5 years or so, but that's accelerating to maybe like VCs raising funds every 2 or 3 years. Yep. Like what are your thoughts on this? Or is this actually happening? Or is this like a skewed perception that
The periodicity of fundraising has really shrunken.
Yeah.
And you know, one of my favorite quotes, something I learned at Princeton, and the best thing that ever happened to me at Princeton was I was the coverage person at Princeton for Greylock. So I just like, I just became a Henry McCants barnacle. You know, Henry was one of the founders of Greylock. And I would just stand next to him and just like try to soak up wisdom. And he once said to me, he said, Douvos, when venture works well, or any asset class actually for that matter, capital is really expensive and time is cheap. And he goes, what we saw in the bubble was that capital got really cheap and time got really expensive, right? And what really stresses me out is when the money is kind of flowing through the system so quickly, time is a scarce commodity, right? And this is one of the things that really worries me with respect to the kind of the environment today. There's, you know, kind of too much activity, too many dollars going to marginal projects. You know, founders, you know, there are founders out there who should be employees, right? There are venture capitalists who should be, you know, street sweepers. I'm just kidding. but you know, but there's just too much, you know, kind of activity, and the velocity is too high. You know, this gets to, you know, one of my favorite lines. You know, F. Scott Fitzgerald talks about New York in 1927. He said the tempo of the city had changed sharply, and I love that line. Like, you know, he said the restlessness approached hysteria, right? And that's how venture can feel sometimes today, and that's the opposite of what it should be.
So I guess sort of related to this, no one else to ask this question to, so I'm going to ask you. So we listened to Mark Andreessen at lunchtime. He was talking about this idea of a new asset class around kind of venture project finance, this idea of doing big deals over structured periods of time, being able to make like these big investments from venture and like capital intensive projects, kind of like doing SpaceX without having to be an internet billionaire before you do it, kind of thing.
Yep.
And he says that's banging around the valley a little bit. And it seems to take care of some of this idea of allocating some of this capital that's potentially free in projects that, you know, really could advance and make a big impact. Have you seen any of that idea, or what do you think about that as an asset class? Like you think about these things.
You know, I'm not one to argue with Mark. The question is, so it's an interesting question, right? Who, you know, here we sit around, we say that venture is the longest dated, furthest out of the money option, right? And I think, when I think of that, I think early stage venture, right? And we're growing these companies, but yet there are these like, you know, mega projects, right? And so I think that that's you know, my own two cents is that's really interesting, right? Because at some level, venture has replaced corporate R&D, right? Like you think of what Bell Labs used to do, or Sarnoff, or some of these, you know, entities, you know, these big kind of moonshot projects. And we've replaced that with early stage innovation, but maybe there's a place for what Mark describes. I don't know the details of it, but there's something intuitively interesting. The challenge is the number of institutions out there that are willing to lock up money, you know, for that long a horizon, you know, in that illiquid a way is pretty limited. Now that said, you know, endowments, you know, we always said at Princeton, we're BLT investors. We invest beyond the long term, right? Some sovereign wealth funds should be well positioned to do that, right? You know, there are other investors. But that said, you've got to make sure that you've got the right people, like the Venn diagram of the people that can do it and the people who have the courage to do it, you know, that intersection is actually probably pretty small. But if anybody can pull it off, it's Mark.
Yeah, he just had this interesting approach of like committing $500 million to a project and then, you know, having clear deliverables and then just, you know, making that money available over time. And the idea being that 10 out of 20 would drop out. And I don't know, it just sounded intriguing as a way to...
Well, you know, it's a good question here. Like, you think about something like Hyperloop One, right? I mean, that's something that is a very interesting project, but I don't think that's a venture investment, right? Certainly not in the way we think about, you know, venture funds, where we want, you know, our money out, you know, our weighted dollar back out in like year 9 or 10, right? I mean, you're talking about a 20-year horizon thing. And then you start talking about principal agent problems, right? Like, depending on what my personal incentives might be, you know, if I'm somebody at a sovereign wealth fund and I'm getting paid on, you know, 3-year performance, it might be a challenge for me to invest in something where I'm not going to see the results for 20 years. Now, you can structure milestones, but I think you need to kind of orient those around liquidity as well.
And I think probably another reason why a lot of these capital intensive projects are being funded is because the amount of capital that's available, there's like so much capital available, both like, I guess like there's a lot of international capital available as well. Like, how do you as kind of a US-based institutional fund think about competing with, for example, like foreign capital that's pouring into VC?
You know, it's really interesting because in World War II, there was this moment, like, you know, Hitler had invaded, you know, Poland and Czechoslovakia and all these places, and then there was this like lull between that and the Battle of Britain, and people, mm-hmm. you know, people in the press started talking about the phony war, right? And it's really interesting because I think about that like right now. You know, I don't know if you guys saw TechCrunch just did this web series called The Down Round, which is a hoot. And they, you know, they're talking about, you know, we're all kind of waiting for the other shoe to drop, right? Prices have been going up and up and up, and, you know, the rate of the second derivative is slowing, right? Like the rate of change of the rate of change is kind of flattening. But people are waiting for the market to kind of crash. But it's, instead of a bubble bursting, it feels more like a deflation. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that is because of the international capital that's flooding mm-hmm. in, specifically some Chinese capital, and then Middle Eastern capital. And I think about that, like, is that a bad thing or a good thing, right? Like, mm-hmm. on the one hand, it's good because it's not creating this huge dislocation. On the other hand, it's kind of sustaining these absurd valuations, right? Mm-hmm. And for me, you know, I tend to be an early stage investor, so it's sustaining absurd late stage valuations, which means I can, you know, kind of keep my paper marks up, right? And my investors still love me. And it's just like that, talk about a principal agent problem, right? Like, I sit around, I go, wow, some of these companies are way overvalued. Yeah. I almost want to haircut them, but, you know, I've got to raise funds too.
Yeah. Yeah. So on that point, how do you think about markups versus liquidity when assessing funds to invest in?
You know, it's really interesting because I wrote a blog post a while back called Syndrome Centers. How many people here have seen the movie The Incredibles, the Pixar movie, right? So remember the bad guy's syndrome. He says, you know, when everybody's super, nobody will be, right? And I think about that when I look at, you know, the average, I calculated one quarter, the average fund that came across my desk had a 37% IRR. I mean, if I could bank a 37% IRR, I could retire in like 6 years. And I remember I had this discussion. Every now and again, I get really feisty, and I feel really dirty afterwards when I do this. But like, somebody called me up, and they said, hey, you know, our fund is a 2.7 cash on cash. And I said, so what are you liquid in? And they said, nothing. We've, you know, this company was just, Sequoia came into this round. So I said, you're not cash on cash. You're 2.6x paper on cash. And they said, no. It's, you know, these are returns. I'm like, they're not returns because you haven't sent any money back to your investors. And I get in these like shouting matches sometimes, and I get really feisty. And this person hung up on me. But it does bring up this point of, you know, until the moolah is in the kula, right? Until mm-hmm. those dollars come back, it's not real, right?
That's a quote.
Yeah. You get, and by the way, like I'll do my capital constipation line, which is one of my favorites, in a second. But you know, back east, there's the fancy car dealership is called Miller Motor Cars in Greenwich, right? Aston Martin, Ferrari, Lamborghini. I've never actually set foot in there. I don't think they would let me set foot in there. But a good friend of mine, he is a patron of Miller Motor Cars, and one year I said to him, this guy I went to college with, and he's a hedge fund guy, and he's too wealthy for his own good. And I said, hey, you know, what's this year's car? Are you getting the new 458 Italia or whatever? He goes, no, man, we had a great relative year, but the fund was still down, and Miller Motor Cars doesn't accept relative performance as a form of payment. And I was like, yeah, you can't. I mean, that's just another riff on you can't eat IRR, mm-hmm. right? What you describe actually is an interesting question because, you know, there's a big circle of life, right? Mm-hmm. And you know, we as LPs send money to the VCs who then invest in companies, and then what happens over time is that the companies get liquid and they send money back to the VCs who send money back to us, and then we can fund the GPs. And this happy mm-hmm. circle is called recycling distributions, right? Mm-hmm. This is where Yale and Stanford and the mature programs are, right? The problem is right now when companies aren't getting liquid, but the returns, you know, the paper returns are going up, mm-hmm. you've got this capital constipation, right? It's mm-hmm. you've got a clogged exit sphincter, right? This is I said this at TechCrunch once, and I've somebody now calls me sphincter boy, but when you've got this kind of capital constipation and the money isn't kind of flowing, mm-hmm. it creates this real distress because as an institution, you know, our allocation of venture is going up, mm-hmm. And it's great we can tell our trustees that our venture portfolio is performing. But there's no money to fund the new commitments. And at some point, we have a ceiling on how big our portfolio can be, and we'll start bumping. This is where a lot of LPs are today, right? Everybody's kind of bumping up against the top. And then, by the way, what happens, it's weird, is at Princeton, we had one company, a company called Acterna, which was this optical switch company that was funded by a big venture capital firm that was a big position for us. And that company was valued at $1 billion, which in the late 90s was actually a lot of money. Today it's nothing.
It's like a unicorn, what?
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah, right,
like,
whatever.
Yeah,
seriously, right? And because it was such a large position, we were so big in that fund, and that company had zero revenue, by the way, it was marked at $1 billion. When that company was written off to zero, that was a 10 basis point hit on the Princeton endowment, mm-hmm. right? Like that was like, holy smokes. Like, and now why does that matter? Like it sucks that our, you know, we took this hit. But the thing that really sucks about it is we had spent that money. So 3 years that company had been valued at $1 billion, we spent 5% of our ownership, right? Like mm-hmm. as part of our spend roll. So we had spent money that was ephemeral, right? Mm-hmm. And that actually like ate away at some of our corpus.
Yeah. So are there slides that you want to cover that I just didn't let you cover at all?
I think we hit most of them. I gave this presentation I was on the faculty at the Kauffman Fellows Program a couple of weeks ago, and so I just repurposed this. The only one that that I might talk about, and this is actually an interesting challenge. So the anthropologist Stephen Jay Gould wrote a paper a long time ago called Entropic Homogeneity. And basically what he said is like in all fields of human endeavor, when things are new, there's a broad dispersion. And then as best practices get diffused through that area, there's a convergence of the best and the worst, right? And so he said, look, one of his examples that I remember is baseball batting average. So in the 1890s, the average major league batting average was 260. but there was like an 80-point standard deviation. And then when he wrote this article in the late 80s, the batting average, the average MLB mean average was 260, the same, but now the standard deviation was 20 points, right? And so you had this real narrowing. And so I think about this, I haven't updated this slide in a while, but this is really interesting to me. So the Yale guys always, you know, in Swenson's book, there's a famous chart that shows the dispersion between top and bottom quartile performers and venture is greater than in any other asset class. So you can see here, this is a bar chart representing the top quartile performance minus the bottom quartile performance. For venture capital in blue, leveraged buyouts in orange, natural resources in yellow, whatever that is, pukey green, and then real estate in purple. So that's a dispersion between, so basically if you choose well, you have that much better a return. And what you see is this huge dispersion in venture from 1993 to 2002, but 2003 to 2012, the dispersion is the same as the other asset classes. And so there's this actually interesting question of, you know, do you have a pennant, if you plot the top and bottom quartiles, do you have like this pennant-like, triangle-like convergence to kind of, you know, mediocrity over time. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, that's the effect of too much money in an asset class. And that's why as we think about venture capital, as we think about innovation, we need to think about new ways to kind of create those discontinuous outcomes so that there is real compensation to taking those crazy risks and taking that illiquidity and long time horizon.
Cool. So you obviously have a blog, and we can learn more about your thoughts through that blog, and some of the classes read some of the blog already as part of class reading.
Oh, cool.
So I think most people have.
Awesome.
So how did you get into blogging, and like how, I guess, superlp.com, all that?
So, you know, there was this moment where blogging was new, mm-hmm. and one of the most prominent bloggers was Josh Koppelman at First mm-hmm. Round. And Josh and I were sitting there one morning, and I was talking to him about how he had created a brand among entrepreneurs, and he was like, and I was telling him, you know, I'd love to create a brand among VCs because I no longer walked around with a fuzzy, you know, orange pea on my chest from Princeton as a TIF. Now, how do I become seen as a thought leader? And he goes, Douvos, I got just the idea for you. Why don't you start blogging? He goes, you're no smarter than the next guy, but you can be at least 20 to 25% funnier. Mm-hmm. And as a result, you have a great voice and people actually read it. And so I was like, oh, wow, cool. So like oftentimes I'm like writing stuff and I'm like, I don't know if this is like really profound, but it's like presented in an easily accessible way. Yeah. And the initial impulse for the blog was to really make what is an opaque area of investment, you know, kind of limited partnership investing, much more transparent. And it's been fun. It's been a great journey. I don't blog as often as I'd like, but I just flew to Korea and I wrote 3 posts on the plane, so I'm gonna kind of feed those out over the next few days.
Cool.
Few weeks. So stay
tuned.
A few
weeks, okay. Sounds good. Thanks.
Is there a question?
Or yes, one more question. Two more questions.
Okay, a very quick question. What are the top 3 common mistakes do those like first time VCs make? Even for those top performers?
So among first time VCs? I've had more heartache among first-time VCs from team stress issues. I think that people underestimate how difficult it is, right? A partnership is like a marriage, right? And it creates a lot of stress, and there's a lot of dynamics that people don't anticipate. So team stress is one. Another is, especially as we've seen, you know, as we go to the slide with the, you know, the 300, you know, micro VC funds, a lot of those funds are former operators, you know, entrepreneurs who are making the transition to investing. And I think that the transition to investing is much, much harder than people think. In fact, if you look at the greatest VCs of all time, I'd say the majority are not people who came out of operating backgrounds. So Mike Moritz was a journalist, right? People like Jim Breyer started as associates or Jeff Yang, associates out of business school, maybe with a couple of years experience. You know, Dave Marquardt at August, you know, some great, you know, kind of folks. So that's an area that I think is a challenge. And then the third right now is I think people's ambitions are too large. So I meet a lot of VCs trying to raise first funds that are trying to raise $50 or $100 million. And I said, no, you gotta crawl before you can walk, you gotta walk before you can run. So raise a much smaller fund, a more modest pool, demonstrate that proof of concept, and then build off of that.
You mentioned about the principal problem, so I'm just curious, like,
So it's interesting because there can be principal-principal problems associated with either heterogeneous, some sort of heterogeneity, right? So whether you have, some people might have different tax footprints, right? So it's interesting because you might see, you know, in a fund, some of the investors, even who think like principals, might say, you know, let's distribute this stock. While others might say let's sell the stock and distribute cash, right? And those have different tax implications. And you know, well-intentioned, kind of good, you know, thoughtful investors can come out on, you know, on different sides of that. Different people have different views about the future, right? And so you can see it, but I feel like those are less artificial cleavages, right? Because they're cleavages between people based on their view of doing what's right for the capital, as opposed to what's doing right for themselves, with some slippage between cup and lip of, you know, kind of what's right for themselves and what's right for the capital.
Other questions?
Yeah. So I was a little confused on your overall strategy and what your competitive advantages. I know from a fund to fund, so you're basically taking an extra fee. And if you're a smart, knowledgeable, institutional, potential LP, why not just go directly to these VCs? So
sure.
Who are you really catering to, and what do you consider your secret sauce?
So it's a great question. And I think most fund to funds don't have a compelling value proposition and are ripe for disintermediation. And that's what we've seen over the last 10 years. With respect to me particularly, I've got a kind of an existing portfolio, set of relationships, and kind of brand footprint that I see things before other people do. And, you know, I made the point about kind of flying out from Princeton once a quarter and talking to folks. You're so far behind the curve as to be, you know, kind of almost irrelevant. I'm not saying that Princeton is, because Princeton has some advantages, but if you look at the investors in my fund, you know, guys like I mentioned, you know, Case Western, Carnegie Mellon, you know, great folks who have existing venture programs, right? They've got, you know, in some cases very good programs, but what they don't have is they don't have a view into the things that are kind of popping up and the next generation of great GPs. And it's extremely difficult, if not impossible, to kind of determine that kind of flying in from Jacksonville or Pittsburgh or Cleveland, once a quarter. You need to dedicate. What I love about my investors is they acknowledge that that they're understaffed relative to the challenge. And then another part of my personal value proposition is that I then believe I'm a partner to these folks in helping them continue to build their programs. So I'm their bird dog and their Sherpa, and then help them get access to things. So for instance, Data Collective, which is a new fund that was kind of came into being in 2012, I found those guys, was their first investor, and then introduced them. And then over time, I think 7 of my investors ended up coming into the fund. And in the first fund, we ended up being like 44% of the fund together. So, but they never would have found Data Collective, right? Had I not been kind of bird dogging that and bringing that to their attention.
Yeah, it's like 2 kind of related questions. So, do you work with any individual LPs versus institutional? And then, just as like, given someone is interested in becoming an LP but having no clue how the industry works, what do you recommend as the first step? Doing your research and deciding who you want to work with.
I've no clue what I'm doing. So if you come up with an answer to that question, kidding aside, to the first question, we do take investments from individual investors, although they make up a very small percentage of our capital base. And they tend to be affiliated in some way, board members or in some cases even staffers at institutions where we manage money. And but it's actually great because in some cases those are super sophisticated folks. And kind of one thing I do kind of with respect to kind of being a Sherpa is like, you know, I have a field trip every year. And I bring out all my investors and take them to, you know, it's like a two-day thing. I take them to portfolio companies, and I have a pizza oven in my backyard in Palo Alto, and we toss pizzas. And you know, one of my investors is my saucier, and you know, it's like very participatory, and everybody gets a kick out of it. I invite entrepreneurs and VCs over, and it's, you know, it's this great kind of mix and mingle. But I find that the individual investors are actually much more tolerant of risk. And more dynamic, but they just happen to make up a small number because they're also hard to find. With respect to kind of becoming an LP, I think that today, I was part of this great wave in kind of 01 where a bunch of people came into the business on the heels of Swenson's book. From like 99 to 01, the ranks of LPs swelled. And a lot of the people who were kind of in senior positions, and I think of people like, you know, Du Chai, who's now at Horsley Bridge, who started at Northwestern, or you know, Tina Sir, who was the CIO at NYU, or you know, there were a bunch of people that kind of, really came out. Today it's much more competitive and the business is shrinking rather than expanding. The thing I tell people is to kind of find a path that brings some kind of unique value. So for some people that's, you know, having worked either at a venture fund or in a company where, you know, a portfolio company where you've maybe got some insights on how to do co-investments, right? And you can be kind of a co-investment analyst. That's probably the area that's growing most. In other cases, seeing if you can weasel your way into, you know, the kind of classic path has been to find your way into an endowment as kind of an associate or even an intern. And then it's such a clubby world that you kind of can find many paths that way. But today just being a conventional LP is a kind of hard path.
Cool. Thanks again, Chris.
Thank you guys.